Hello all, I welcome you all to the 10th lecture of this course E614. During our previous lectures, we discussed about semiconductors, carriers in semiconductors, the existence of band gap, intrinsic, extrinsic semiconductors, and various transport properties like drift, diffusion, and effect of temperature, and so on and so forth, right? So from now onwards, we will discuss an the incorporation of these concepts into a device, and we will discuss a PN junction diode, right? And we will mostly be discussing a PN junction diode in the with a silicon wafer, right? So we will discuss the various fabrication techniques and some important semiconductor device fabrication techniques, which is pertaining only to the discussion that we will do on a junction diode, right? So most of the time when people talk about silicon, they tend to mention only it as a single crystal silicon, right? So a single crystal silicon is one which has extremely low defect densities and extremely high purity. So they have something of the sort of 9 ns purity, in the sense it is 99.9 or 11 ns, right? So 99.9999, like this, you have 9 times this, or sometimes 11 nines or 9 nines or 11 nines, something of that sort of the kind of impurity, right? It has a defect density of the order of 10 to the power like 4 to 6 per centimeter cube, which is among the lowest defect density that you can find in materials which can be manufactured in large areas, right? The most common method to grow a single crystal silicon is called the Sosalsky method, right? So Sosalsky's method. I'm sure you must have seen this sometime before. You either have a big furnace where silicon is molten, right? And then you bring in a seed crystal. There are a lot of videos in YouTube which you can see, and then you pull it out, and then you form what is called as a silicon ingot, right? This ingot is a single crystal, and then people start to cut this into various wafers, and then we use it, right? So before we go into details about silicon, there are a few important properties of silicon that I will reiterate. Most likely you have seen this before, but then it will be useful for all our discussions henceforth, right? So silicon is a cubic semiconductor. You know, it's an FCC. It's a type of a cubic with an atomic motif, right? It has an atomic mass of 28.085 gram. It has a lattice spacing A of 0.54 angstroms. Right, this is what we saw before. It has an atomic density. We calculated this in our homework, but I'm just citing it for our purposes. It has an atomic density of 5 into 10 to the power 22 per centimeter cube. It has a dielectric constant called epsilon. We saw dielectric constant in our previous discussions on optical properties, right? It has a dielectric constant of 11.9, right? It's a ratio of speed of light. It has a conduction band density of states of about 2.8 into 10 to the power 19. You know this, right? Because we have calculated certain things, and you know that this number is useful in calculating the density of electrons. The valence band density of states is about 1 into 10 to the power 19 per centimeter cube. It has an electron affinity. Do anybody know what is electron affinity? It's about 113.6 kilojoule per mole. Electron affinity is, let's say we have a band structure like this. This is the conduction band, this is the valence band, and let us say you have a Fermi level here. The electron affinity is the energy from the bottom of the conduction band to back. It is the amount of energy that is required to take an electron from the bottom of the conduction band to vacuum. Typically, In metals, you have what is called as a work function, which is the energy required from to remove an electron from the Fermi level to vacuum. However, in a semiconductor, this does not make sense, right? Because Fermi level, many in most semiconductors fall in the band gap where there are no electrons per se, right? It has a band gap EG of about 1.12 EV. It has an intrinsic carrier density of about 10 power 10 per centimeter cube. It has a breakdown field. What's a breakdown field? We will discuss more about this later on. It is volt per centimeter. It has an electron mobility of about 1400 centimeter square per volt second. It has an hole mobility of about 450 centimeter square. These are typical numbers, right? Their diffusion constant is about 36 centimeter square per second. Electron diffusion and hole diffusion constant is about 12 centimeter square per second. Okay. So these are one of the most commonly used properties of silicon. We will need this in our discussions to understand silicon and its transport, right? Now, with this given, we will discuss some of the important material processing techniques that we use in silicon to fabricate devices, in the sense that there are certain reasons why silicon is among the most used semiconductor. One big reason for that is the fact that it has a very stable oxide. So here, if you see, these are there are two different ways in which silicon dioxide can be formed on top of silicon. We previously saw that silicon dioxide can have properties important for various purposes, right? I'm not sure if you would have heard about this, but then if you want to make a CMOS transistor, metal oxide semiconductor stacks, we will see all these things as we go forth. But then one of the main reasons why silicon is so famous is because it has such stable oxide. So here is an TEM image of a silicon dioxide silicon interface. The dots here belong to silicon atoms, and you can see them being at this very nice cubic structure. And on top we have silicon dioxide, which is an amorphous material which sits on top of a epitaxial or highly crystalline silicon without a lot of defects. So it is this defect density which is typically in the order of about let us say lesser than 10 to the power 10 per centimeter square in silicon dioxide interfaces. In other semiconductors like silicon HFO2 oddish semiconductors, it is greater than about 10 to the power 13 per centimeter square. It is about 3 orders of magnitude higher in any other system, right? The most common way to grow the silicon dioxide is by what is called as a wet oxidation and dry oxidation method. And you take the silicon substrate to temperatures in the order of 800 to 1000, and then you pass either oxygen, giving you this expression, Si plus O2 giving SiO2, or you pass water as a vapor, then you get this expression, right? Either ways, you form silicon dioxide. The rate at which you form and the quality of oxide you form are very different in the case whether you use dry, you call it dry when you use dry oxygen, or you call it wet when you use water, right? Obviously, you can see that the growth rate, as shown here, the growth rate as an oxidation time, right? Let us say in 1 hour, the rates at different temperatures are plotted here. At 850 degrees in 1 hour, you form about 100 nanometers, whereas at 850 degrees in 1 hour, you do not form even let us say 10 nanometers in dry oxide. However, the quality of oxide, in the sense of number of defects it has, how much is the leakage current and all those things, the dry oxide is much better. So these are tricks that the an experimental semiconductor fabrication person will use to choose which is the kind of oxide that they have to use. Another important step which is used in semiconductor device fabrication is impurity incorporation. It is through this that we do doping, right? So we talked about intrinsic semiconductors, extrinsic semiconductors and doping and so forth, right? There are different ways in which you can dope a semiconductor. One way is called as alloy formation. What we do is we take the semiconductor as we shown here and then we put a metal drop on top, the dopant particularly, right? And then heat this stack together. So what happens when you heat them together? You have to understand this only with the means of a phase diagram. Here we have phase diagram which tells you which is the most stable phase. People typically go to what is called as a eutectic point. This is the point at which you form the lowest liquid alloy of this system. So in this system we have silicon and we have aluminum, right? This is an example of silicon aluminum stack. At some temperature, so here it is about 550 oddish temperature, and you have a particular concentration which is about 15, right? Something 12.6, as is directly pointed out here. At 12.6 aluminum percentage at 450 degrees, you form a liquid alloy which is stable, right? So this eutectic point tells you the lowest temperature at which the liquid will be stable, right? So you reach this point, you form an aluminum silicon alloy and then you cool it down. So what happens is that alloy is what is the region which is considered to be doped, right? And the region which and the part of silicon and the part and any excess aluminum that you have added to the system will just be evolved out, right? And they also form as an additional contact. So if you see here, you have an aluminum which forms the ohmic contact and you have a region in the silicon in which the alloy has been formed. And this is a way in which you can form or you can create a region where aluminum is doped, is doping silicon. Aluminum has a valency 3. So what is the kind of a doping that you think it will form? P-type. Well, a second way to do this diffusion is called as a solid state diffusion. So what people do is they take a huge furnace, right, and then heat it to temperatures like 1000 degrees, 800 to 1000 degrees. They place the silicon wafer at the center and then they place the another solid state dopant. If you want to dope with boron, you put what is called as a boron bromide and then you pass an inert gas at such high temperature. So what happens is this inert gas will carry the boron which is getting decomposed at such temperatures and it is driven to the silicon wafer. So here we have silicon, right? So what happens is the silicon surface has a lot of boron that is dropping from the top, right? And what happens, the boron starts to diffuse in the silicon and it is described by this equation which is called as a Fick's relation. So it is dou square C. C is the concentration of boron in silicon. Dou C by dou T by time is some D, which is called as a diffusion constant. Del square C by del X square. Does this equation seem very familiar to you? We just saw this a day or a class or two before. You must have seen this in Shockley's and Haynes experiment, where you saw this in a different form, but then in different variables, the form is similar. The solution is a Gaussian, as you can see here, right? And D is the diffusion coefficient. Diffusion at any time t is given by this expression. D is equal to D naught is some constant, into e power minus del E by kt. This del E is called the activation barrier that it has to cross, and as at higher and higher temperatures, the activation barriers are crossed much easily, and then you have a much higher diffusion constant at higher temperatures, right? And if the surface of the silicon, let's say here, has some constant density because it is being constantly driven from the top, if it has a constant density here, then the solution is not truly a Gaussian, but it's called as an error function, which in most cases will be similar. But then if I take this as the boundary of silicon wafer, right, and if I keep on populating it by boron, the concentration will drop in this Gaussian sort of a way, right? And you can see that it can be approximated to be a kind of a box. And hence, If we use the solid state diffusion, people typically use what is called as an abrupt junction approximation. Right? In addition to this, you can also see that if I'm masking a certain region by silicon dioxide is known to be a very good diffusion stopper, in the sense that the diffusion constant D naught is much smaller in silicon dioxide than in silicon. So what happens is if I drive boron, boron will just stop at the interface and nothing will penetrate through. Now if I have a small gap in silicon dioxide as is shown here, you will have penetration only here and nothing on the sides. Right? So that gives you this nice diffusion at the point where it is open. This is another advantage why silicon dioxide is used or is an important material in semiconductor device fabrication. Right? The third important method to dope is called as ion implantation. This is used for some very specific purposes. So what they do is they take the silicon wafer, and then let us say this is the silicon wafer. Once again, you can use diffusion stoppers like silicon dioxide. What they do is, instead of heating the entire thing at high temperatures, they just create a plasma of ionized dopants. And this plasma can obviously be accelerated by applying an electric bias, right? So this plasma, let us say if I have positive ions, will be accelerated by a negative potential which is applied to the substrate. And then you will have this huge velocity with which the atoms will come and they can get incorporated into the substrate. The main advantage of this particular technique is that if you tune the energy so much or properly, you can have the surface to be not having any dopant, and then the doping starts at somewhere at the substrate internals. So basically, the implanted dose has a kind of a Gaussian shape as is shown here, which can be offset from the surface by this term x minus rp. So this is rp, right? So basically what it means is, if you can tune the energy properly, you can have a doping density below the surface. So this is useful for devices where you want to have buried channel and stuff. We will deal with these substrates a little bit later. But then this is another interesting way, and where in which you can have the substrate at room temperature and you can have a very controlled doping profile, which does not have to be a Gaussian starting from the surface as we saw in the previous solid state diffusion case. Right? So we will stop this particular lecture now, and then we will go ahead and then start to analyze a PN junction a little bit more deeply in the next part. Thank you.